So I'm going to talk about basically the analytics side of what you just heard, so IoT analytics. So you got a good introduction on like what IoT is, like what the IoT server can do. So I'm going to talk about the analytics side of IoT. So I'm going to first start out with some scenarios of IoT analytics in action, basically. So Sumedh also mentioned this when like passing by in his talk. So so this is basically a Rolls-Royce Trent 1000. So so this is the engine that is used in the Boeing Dreamliner, the airplane. So so as he mentioned also, so this has like thousands of sensors built into it. And so all the engines that are run by Rolls-Royce, they can monitor this in their headquarters, basically in UK. So anything that happens in the engines, they can identify in their, basically in their offices. So if something goes wrong, if something is not working correctly, they can right away like contact the airline and like give an alert. So it's, so that's IoT in action, basically. So all the parts there, so everything is connected, and so because of that, they can have this kind of like information and functionality. So basically, this information is collected right from the beginning, like from design, manufacture, and after sales, all throughout, they gather this information. Like for example, I have mentioned here one fan blade manufacturing creates half a terabyte of data. So you can just imagine the amount of data that is created when, like even when making the engine. So likewise, so when in operation, it also creates like huge amounts of data. So same situation in Caterpillar. So they have a lot of like from like autonomous mining trucks to locomotives, they have all sort of sorts of equipment, and so they are also they have a lot of sensors installed where they can get like a lot of status data, like how they are operating and so on. They can gather this data, and so basically using this, they can use that data to make sure the equipment is working in the most efficient way. So also another branch of their, like their marine services, they also use predictive maintenance. Like when they do, for example, like ship maintenance, they have also like they manage ships. So they do like, for example, hull cleaning. So they have checked and identified that if we maintain a specific interval in their hull cleaning, they can like save millions per year in cost. So likewise, another example is they have identified fuel pump replacement. So without coming to the edge of like with, for them to fail, if you like service them and replace them in the proper time, they can save a lot of money. So those are some of the use cases where IoT analytics are already used in real life. So now let's check, okay. So how are mainly IoT analytics categorized? So Sumedh also touched on this a little bit. So mainly, so we have to think about what type of data we are going to get. So, and how fast you need results out of your analysis. And after that, after the processing and everything, how much data to keep. And then the mode of analytics you are going to use, whether you are going to do like historical analytics or current real time, or you are going to predict something. And also like the approach or the mode of the analytics execution, like are you going to do like cloud-based analytics, or are you going to do like edge analytics, like doing the analytics at the device itself? So those are some of the areas that we have to, the categories of IoT analytics. So so these are one of the two main types of data we have, like time related data, like a lot of data we get from IoT, there would be a timestamp, like to say when did this happen. So this we call time series processing when you're actually processing it for something. For example, some devices, energy consumption with time. And with that, we can probably do like failure prediction, like, okay, so looking at the time and the usage, I suppose that this is going to fail in this time, and so on. So we can do that kind of prediction when we have these types of data. And so also, so these type of data, so when we are storing, we also have like specialized databases. For example, this OpenTSDB is one of the examples, like it is meant for time series processing. So when you're storing it, it stores in an optimal way that you can retrieve it in a much faster and efficient manner. Another one is location data. So another often used type of data, like when you have a lot of small devices in the physical world, maybe you want to find where, like, you want to get data where they are and so on. So the most typical ones are like GPS-based devices. So they will give like a GPS location to where the device is at. So for example, those can be like cars, trains, and so on. So anything that is outdoors, you can get with GPS. And also another mechanism is when you have devices indoors. So in an when you have something inside a building, you can't have GPS. So in those kind of situations, we can use technology like the iBeacon technology. So iBeacon is basically Apple-based technology that was brought up by Apple. So and there are a lot of iBeacon-based devices now out there. So it's basically using a Bluetooth low power specs to basically send out a device ID and some proximity data. So using that, you can have like a somewhat accurate positioning of some devices that are inside a building or somewhere like that. So that's ways of getting the location. And some areas we have used this location data is, for example, we can use that in like agriculture. So for example, if you have these sensors in different areas to like detect the soil moisture and crop growth and so on, so you can then plan out and like better manage your crops. So we have to grow them, how to manage the resources to them and so on. So those kind of things can be done with the location-based analytics. And of course, a very popular one is traffic planning. So like with GPS and other location devices, cell-based positioning and so on, you can do route suggestions and so on. Like for example, if you guys have noticed, like in Sri Lanka also, we recently got like traffic status updates in Google Maps. So what they basically do is they use your mobile phone to get the position and the situation, the current situation, and they create basically the traffic situation at that point. So they are basically exploiting the biggest IoT device you have, your cell phone, and doing the calculations. And same way as the time-related data, so in location also, so there are specialized databases and computation systems that work on that. So you can store the data, and for example, like this GeoTrellis, they basically it's a special computation engine which does like geospatial operations. So with that, you can very efficiently do geo-related operations in the system. So the other one is the processing modes, IoT. Like the questions would be, when do we really need the results from some analytics job? Like, do we need it real time, or if a small delay is okay, or like a big delay of minutes or hours is also okay? So we have to answer these questions and select a proper like a execution model that we want to use. So the most popular one is real time or near real time. So that means when we are getting events from the IoT devices, then and there we do some computation and take some action, like alerts and so on. So that means we will have a system which will look at each event and maybe do some processing and like execute some rules and so on, and get some result out of the system. So so basically we call this usually stream processing, and a very popular stream processing system is basically Apache Storm. It's a popular one now, like it's very scalable and fault tolerant. So so it can be used to create your own custom stream processing topologies. And if you need like much complicated real-time scenarios, like it pattern matching and so on, you can use a full-fledged CP engine as well, like for example WSO-CP, ESPA and so on. And another thing to notice with WCP, so CP itself can be like scaled up using Apache Storm. Like we have the support for that by using the WCP engine as a bolt in Apache Storm, basically. So you can scale the real-time nature very much by using Apache Storm and CP together. And the other mode is basically the interactive and the batch. So for long-term statistics generation, like if you want some stats like the average temperature in a room the last month and so on, we can basically use a batch processing system. So for example, so you may have heard like very popular Apache Hadoop, Apache Spark and so on. So can be used to look at a lot of stored events from IoT devices and do some processing and get the results back. Like, and these results can obviously be shown in a dashboard or something that that is useful for the user. And also, interactive analytics can also be used with technologies such as Apache Drill. And maybe with special database systems like Couchbase. So Apache Drill, basically you can use to, if you have some data that is like, in that case, self-describing, like without giving a specific schema, it can drill down and explore the data then and there. So another thing is, so the batch and the real-time, what I mentioned earlier, can be like mashed together and used like together by using this mechanism. We like some people call it the Lambda architecture. So that is where we do some computation in the batch system, and we store it somewhere, and that is basically referenced in our real time pipeline. So you can have a most probably like compare the most current events or the values with the earlier processed batch results. So that also can be done as a general pattern. And also, we can incorporate a general indexing system, like for example, like Apache Lucene, and we also have same function in WSO-DAS to do the necessary lookups when you have a lot of data stored from the device and so on, and look it up when needed. So that also can be used as an interactive mechanism to retrieve the data when needed. So yeah, so the next part is basically the IoT analytics data retention. So
obviously you will be getting a lot of data from these devices that is in the environment. So then you have to decide whether you should keep all the data or whether you should discard them eventually. So that's the retention, so the strategy you should follow. So usually with the big data technologies we have, with the big data data source and so on, we can afford to keep the data also. But eventually, someday you will have to like get some data deleted. So you will have to use like some kind of purging mechanism to delete some data as you go. Like especially if you are doing like a batch operation, if you don't have a proper incremental processing approach, it will not scale. The system will not scale if you keep on growing the data in a very high rate. So because of that, we should consider this aspect as well when you are designing your system. So, then for the IoT analytics processing, so these are the different types of analytics you can do. Like, so main things are hindsight, insight, foresight. So hindsight is basically you process the historical data and get an idea like, okay, what has happened? So what has happened earlier, and okay, I need to get an idea of that. So that can be done with the batch processing systems I mentioned earlier. And with that, and also obviously with the data visualization system, so with dashboards. So those two should be used to like get an idea, okay, this is how my system was doing earlier. And then the insight would be, okay, how is it working now? Like, okay, so that's basically what is happening now. So that is achieved with real-time processing systems. So like mentioned earlier, like W3CP or anything, any similar real-time processing system, you can get this information. That is, okay, how is it doing now? For example, in the earlier jet engine scenario, you would most probably want to get the current status of the engines. Okay, like how is it doing now, rather than for example, if something is wrong with the jet engine, you don't want it to get the data, do a long batch operation, and after 1 hour, say, your engine is not doing well. So then if you call the pilot and say, okay, that's too late then. So likewise, so that kind of things should be done in real time. And of course, the next step would be predicting what is going to happen. That's foresight. So that is achieved with the machine learning technologies. So for example, we have Apache Mahout that works on Hadoop, and Apache Spark MLlib, and so on. And of course, our own W3ML, so which can do this predictive analysis as we need. And so the scenarios, the possible scenarios are, so I mentioned earlier, predictive maintenance. Like, okay, so something like that will say, okay, is it time to change some specific parts in my car? Like, maybe like looking at the airflow of the car, we can say, okay, it's time to change the airflow sensor, something like that. Or service scheduling on an aeroplane, like looking at the past service history, the current service schedules, and so on, you can say, okay, you should be servicing your aeroplanes in this time. So likewise. So so that, of course, those kind of things can be done with the predictive analytics. So of course we know like we get a lot of data from the IoT devices, so there are so lot of things and there are a lot of processing going on. So so at the end it may, so mainly in the future, it may not always be feasible to do the processing in a centralized place. Like if you're getting like millions of like data from millions of IoT devices to a single system, it may not be able to handle all that load. All that processing power may not be at a single place. So a possible approach would be like without taking it to a central place, like maybe taking it to a cloud or anything, we get the cloud down and get it to the edge of the network. Like some people call it fog analytics or edge analytics. So what happens there is basically some of the analytics is done at the device itself. So like some aggregations, some kind of computation is done at the device and sent to the a central gateway or the analytics server or anything like that. So you have the option to do some of the work or to some extent and send it out. So it will like relieve the burden of the analytics systems a lot. So this is also a trend that is emerging for analytics, where edge analytics will make the work much more easier for the other downstream analytics work. So let me give a small, also like a reference architecture for IoT analytics using the W0 technologies. So so I have like drawn a small flow here, and so starting with some devices. So you get some devices somewhere. So let's say you communicate with MQTT to communicate with the analytics server. So you will have MQTT broker, and we'll be using the W2 data analytics server to subscribe to these data streams. And the first thing we would be doing is when we get something into the system, we may want to like, okay, the first thing is we will dump all the raw data. So just in case if you want to revisit the data later. So this data may not be complete, like you may need to clean some data and so on. So the first operation can be that. So we'll be running, executing some CP execution plans, and the first one would be to clean that data. So fill in some fields and so on, and clean it. And basically after that, persist the clean data. So all of this will go to a big data store like HBase, Cassandra, or something similar. And so now we have both the raw data and the cleansed data there. And in the same pipeline, we would be executing our real-time execution plans. So there we will be having the basically the logic to have the real-time alerts and so on. And we will trigger them and send it to a basically a dashboard. So for that, for the real-time alerts and so on, we'll be using like you can use WebSockets to connect the data analytics server and the dashboard and get the real-time events shown in the dashboard, basically. And so after that, so we'll have the batch analytics running in the background. So basically, W3 uses Spark SQL to run the batch analytics. So batch analytics will basically read the data from the centralized data store and read the basically the cleansed data, do some processing, and basically the dashboard will pick up the data from there and show it in the dashboard. So then we have both the real-time dashboard and the real-time like the alerts, like the email and SMS I have shown here, and of course also the results from the batch operations coming into the system. So at the end, so the idea is from device publishing to the dashboard is basically covered here, from real time to batch. And also we have the for predictive analysis, we have the machine learner running. So that will basically, the product is basically for creating the models, the ML models. They will basically read the data from the data store and create the model, and this model will be applied in the data analytics server in the execution, the runtime, and get some data again to the dashboard or as an API to the users. So so that's basically a possible flow of how you can use the IoT data for the analytics. So actually that's it for my presentation. If you
have any questions, I can tell you.